Greetings, fellow nerds. So more lab notes videos on making sodium by the alcohol catalyzed magnesium reduction approach. For those of you just coming into this project, I've been trying to make sodium by reacting sodium hydroxide and magnesium in mineral oil with a tertiary alcohol catalyst. There are various problems and difficulties, but I've worked through them and solved most of them. A couple of big ones were trying to find a way to prevent the glassware from being destroyed by the reaction and finding ways to jumpstart the reaction without using sodium. While not solved perfectly, the solutions I found are within reach of the amateur, so I'm not going to research them further. This leaves one final issue I've been saving for last since it's so critical. Where to get an easily accessible source of tertiary alcohol catalyst? So far I've been using 3-ethyl-3-pentanol that I made myself by the Grignard reaction as seen in a previous video. I also made a bunch of other alcohols in case it didn't work. I used 7-hexyl-7-tridecanol in a special theory testing experiment to prove that the whole sodium production process was viable and worth opening a full project on. I've linked the associated videos in the video description. While these alcohols are exceptionally good and can be made by the amateur, it's a lot of work and that makes them somewhat expensive in terms of time and effort. They're not available from domestic sources, so if you want to buy them directly, you need to special order them online. To make the sodium production reaction truly amateur friendly, we need to find an alcohol we can use directly, or at least much easier to make than the Grignard reaction. Now the first thing I did wasn't to find an alternative alcohol, but to test if we even need an alcohol. Now I know the theory says we absolutely must have some sort of soluble carrier like an alcohol, but we always need to poke our theory to see if it holds up. The best theories withstand all challenges. There are some alternate theories where the alcohol doesn't actually make sodium but instead suppresses side reactions. To try and test it either way, I set up a new reaction. This time with lithium as reductant along with sodium hydroxide and mineral oil. I heat it up to 125 Celsius and just let it stir for 8 hours. I and many other amateurs have already tried running it with magnesium and that didn't work. But there's always the lingering question if it was just something about the magnesium. Maybe the alcohol actually destabilizes the magnesium oxide coating, allowing the actual metal to react. I don't know, but lithium should be an even easier metal as it's very soft and any coatings are easily ground off as the mixture is stirred. If any metal would work without a catalyst, it would be lithium. Indeed, the lithium broke up over time and the bubbling indicates a reaction is happening. Probably water being consumed as tiny amounts of water are soluble in mineral oil. But as time progressed, the bubbling stopped and if you look closely at the bubbler now, it's backflowing. So what's happening is the lithium is reacting with the hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen in the flask and creating a vacuum. The lithium is so starved to react with something that's eating the air and waste products from the previous reaction. Poor lithium. And still there was no sodium. So it seems alcohol is necessary. To confirm this, I opened the flask, added 1 milliliter of 3-ethyl-3-pentanol and resealed it. And there we go, massive reaction now. The initial burst of activity is probably just the alcohol itself reacting with the lithium to make lithium alkoxide. But it's clear as the time progresses that a lot of stuff is happening. The lithium is making sodium now. I let it run for a couple of days until it stopped producing hydrogen, and indeed we could see sodium in the reaction mixture. Interestingly, the sodium is in tiny droplets and not coalesced into larger globules. I think lithium hydroxide interferes with coalescence. I couldn't get any large sodium spheres even after straining. Overall, this experiment does give strong evidence for the necessity of some sort of catalyst. It doesn't prove exactly what role the catalyst plays, just that it's needed. If this had worked without a catalyst, then maybe it would have also worked with magnesium, but we needed to find better conditions. Lithium is an easy and highly reactive metal. If it doesn't work without a catalyst, then magnesium likely doesn't work without a catalyst as well. Okay, now I want to revisit whether we need primary or tertiary alcohols. Now I and many other amateurs have already tried the simple primary and secondary alcohols of methanol, ethanol, and isopropanol to death. These are probably the most researched alcohols ever for this reaction due to their availability and no one was ever able to get them to work. So I'm not going to try them again. But I do have one primary alcohol that hasn't been tried very much, 1-hexanol. It's part of my collection of professional chemicals, so it's unlikely many amateurs have tried it. So I set up a new reaction this time following the standard sodium pre-dry method, but this time using 1 hexanol as the alcohol. The sodium pre-drying stage proceeded as normal at 125 Celsius as the vigorous hydrogen bubbling confirms. Now you might be wondering why I'm testing 1 hexanol if all the other primary alcohols like methanol and ethanol failed. Why do I think 1 hexanol would be different? One theory is that the lighter alcohols all failed simply because they precipitated out. Their sodium alkoxides have very high melting points and are insoluble in mineral oil, so they would have precipitated out. The tertiary alcohols though are still slightly soluble even as alkoxides, so maybe what we really needed was a soluble primary alkoxide. Sodium hexoxide might be soluble enough to work. Anyway, after bubbling slowed, I let it cool and then added magnesium metal. Then I brought it up to operating temperature of 200 Celsius. Now you might be wondering why I'm doing the drying step and the sodium production step separately. Wouldn't it be easier just to mix all together at once? It would, but I'm doing them separately for research purposes so I can see if each stage is proceeding correctly. In the final video I'll streamline everything by doing it all at once, but for now I'll keep doing things separately to better assess what's going on. Anyway, at first it seems like the 1 hexanol is working as the reaction is brought up to operating temperature. But the reaction fails and the bubbler starts backflowing just a few hours later. It seems like 1 hexanol doesn't work. To confirm that we still need a tertiary alcohol, I injected a half milliliter of 3-ethyl-3-pentanol and continued heating the reaction. And it seems like the tertiary alcohol is still necessary. The reaction is proceeding vigorously and it continued to work a day later. Now we can't draw any firm conclusions from this experiment. Maybe I need an even longer primary alcohol, but for now I'm going to stick with tertiary alcohols. I'm not going to attempt secondary alcohols because the only one I have available is isopropanol, and that has already been tested to death by the amateur community. Additionally, the prevailing theory for why primary and secondary alcohols don't work is that they undergo some sort of alpha elimination reaction under the extreme conditions of the sodium production reaction. Tertiary alcohols are not susceptible to this sort of reactivity. I don't know if this theory is correct, but I don't have sufficient cause to doubt it at this time. Interestingly, this test also gives evidence against another theory that somehow the sodium and magnesium form an alloy that does the sodium production reaction. Here we start with sodium left over from the drying step and add magnesium on top. So we have sodium and magnesium mixed in there. But it still didn't work until we added the tertiary alcohol. So the sodium-magnesium alloy theory loses a lot of ground. Now it may not be totally wrong, maybe the alloy is important, but it still needs the tertiary alcohol to transfer the reagents. It cannot work alone. So moving on, let's try some very easy to get tertiary alcohols. My first candidate that I've been waiting all this time to try is terpenine furoyl, also known as 4-terpineol. Now it looks exotic, but you're going to laugh when I tell you where it can be found. It's one of the main components of domestically available tea tree oil. I got this bottle from my local Walmart. So let's give it a try. First, we do the drying step as usual with tea tree oil. Heat to 125 Celsius until the bubbling stops. Then we add in magnesium metal and heat to 200 Celsius, and it looks like it's working. Now you might be asking why I went through the trouble and expense of making my own tertiary alcohols when I could have just bought some from Walmart. I used them because I wanted a pure, high-grade tertiary alcohol whose properties I understood and behavior I could predict. Tea tree oil is only around 40% of the desired 4-terpineol, and the rest is numerous other natural compounds like terpenes, pinenes, and other hydrocarbons. 4-terpineol itself also has alkene functionality as well. So this, along with all the other substances in tea tree oil, could lead to unpredictable side reactions. Maybe there would be addition reactions, polymerization reactions, isomerization reactions, I don't know. But if something went wrong with our earlier experiments, I would have had a hard time figuring out if it was a truly result of the experiment or an unpredictable side reaction. Remember how much trouble we had trying to solve the glassware destruction problem? Imagine if we had used a reagent that did solve the problem but also destroyed the alcohol. The sodium production reaction would have stopped and we'd falsely assume that glassware destruction was somehow necessary. And that's why we want as much control and predictability as possible. By taking the time to make a pure alcohol that had only the functionality I want, I could eliminate undesired and unpredictable side reactions. And that let me focus on the actual problems in the project. Now that I've optimized everything else, we can go back to the alcohol and test out this tea tree oil, knowing that if it doesn't work, the problem is truly in the catalyst mixture and it's not the result of some other interaction or problem with our reaction conditions. So I let this run and it seemed to stop working after a day. The bubbling wasn't particularly vigorous, so I don't think it worked super fast. The alcohol probably decomposed before it could finish. Straining out the sodium, I see another problem. The sodium is in tiny spheres and not large globules. This is not good since I'm sure a lot of them pass through the sieve. To confirm the alcohol had decomposed, I poured the entire reaction mixture back into the reaction flask along with about 5 grams of extra magnesium and another 1 milliliter of tea tree oil. The reaction did not continue and in fact started to backflow, indicating total reaction failure. So either the alcohol isn't working or the sodium hydroxide was completely consumed. I don't believe this last hypothesis as my subjective observation of the hydrogen bubbling didn't show unusually fast production. I actually think something is inhibiting the reaction. If it was just the alcohol decomposing, then the reaction would have continued when I added more. Since it's not, that means something is inhibiting further reaction. But at least the tea tree oil partially worked. Maybe the 60% other impurities in commercial tea tree oil are causing the problem. Alternatively, maybe the alkene group on the alcohol itself is responsible for these poor results. Nonetheless, these results make me very hopeful. Tea tree oil is extremely easy to obtain. Even with these poor results, I think tea tree oil might be viable with a few improvements and purifications. I'm going to order a very large quantity for testing. While I could do more experiments with just this small bottle, purifications are much easier when you have large quantities to work with. My fractional distillation apparatus has a lot of dead space, so I need at least 100 milliliters or so of liquid to get a good yield. So I'm going to order 1 liter of tea tree oil, which is much cheaper to buy in bulk online than at Walmart. I'm also going to order a few more alternative chemicals like cetyl alcohol and stearic acid. Maybe they'll work better than tea tree oil. Anyway, that was my work so far. I'm very excited for the future because if I can make tea tree oil work, that would perhaps be a greater breakthrough for this process than protecting the glassware. The amateur wouldn't have to spend an excessive amount of time and effort making their own tertiary alcohol or finding T-butanol or T-amyl alcohol. They can just head down to their local Walmart and buy everything they need. That is assuming it can be done. We'll have to run more experiments to be certain, and the lab gods make it a sport of crushing our dreams just as we get hopeful. Let's be cautiously optimistic for now. Thanks for watching. Special thank you to all of my supporters on Patreon for making these science videos possible with their donations and their direction. If you're not currently a patron but would like to support the continued production of science videos like this one, then check out my Patreon page here or in the video description. I really appreciate any and all support.